Welcome learners, my name is Ashish Saxena and today we are going to start one of the most important topic of business studies, that is of financial management. So in the first part of the financial management, we will discuss that what is the basic concept of financial management. This is our first target. We should know that what is the basic idea, what is the basic ideology of the financial management. Then our second topic of the part one would be scope and approaches to financial management. And the third topic is major financial decisions, or we can say the major role of the finance manager plays in an organization. And the fourth and final topic of the part one would be profit maximization versus wealth maximization approach. So this is the menu for the part one. And now we are going to start with the definition and basic concept of financial management. So if we want to define the term finance in a very simple term, then we can say that finance is the provision of money at the time when it is required. Now, if we talk about the finance, every department of the organization is directly or indirectly connected with the financial management, is directly or indirectly connected with the finance function of an organization. Say, for example, we take the purchase department. Now, all the activities of the purchase department are dependent on the finance department. How? Because what is the main role? If we talk about the main role of the purchase department, it is going to be the procurement of the raw material and then get it supplied to the production department. Now, for the purpose of purchasing, for the purpose of procuring the raw material from the market, it will have to get it funds from the finance department. We can take some more examples of other departmental activities like marketing department. For the purpose of promoting the organizational product and services, an organization spends a huge amount of money, and that amount of money again has been financed and sanctioned by the finance manager of the organization. So this is the crux of the finance, that how all the departments of an organization, whether it is big, medium or small, depends on the financial management role. Now, in terms of specific words, if we want to define the financial management, we can say that it is the crux of all managerial activities which deals with the planning and controlling of firms and financial sources. Now, this is a very important line, because here we are discussing two aspects, planning and controlling. Now, planning and controlling of firms' financial resources, this is the main task of the finance manager in an organization. So this is, these are the two main concepts which you should learn, that how to make the planning and how to make the controlling of the financial resources. So this is the main aspect when we talk about the definition of financial management. Now, there is one more famous definition given by Weston Brigham, that financial management is an area of financial decision making, harmonizing individual motives and enterprise goals. So this is one of the important definition given by the Weston Brigham. Again, it is again focused on the planning and controlling aspect of the firm's financial resources. Now, second topic, we will discuss about the scope of financial management. When we talk about the scope of financial management, we can say that we are discussing here about the approaches of financial management. So as far as the history of financial management is concerned, we divide the financial management in two era. Financial management before 1950s and financial management after 1950s. So when we talk about the financial management before 1950s, it is a very surprising to say that financial management was not a separate discipline. It was considered as the part of economics. So before 1950, we have an approach named as traditional approach. And after the 1950s, when the financial management has been separated from the part of economics, we have a new approach which is known as modern approach. So we should understand that what are the two approaches, traditional approach and modern approach. So first of all, we are starting the traditional approach. Now, what the traditional approach is saying? This approach is saying that the scope of finance function is very limited only up to the procurement of funds. This is the term which you should learn. This is the main aspect of the traditional approach, only up to the procurement of funds from the market, nothing else. Now, procurement is not the only task of the financial management. When we start our next chapters, then you came to know that there are n number of multitasking efforts done by a finance manager in an organization. So procurement of funds is just only a single bit of task made by the finance manager, and this is the only task which is supposed to be performed by a finance manager in the traditional approach. Now the procurement refers to, there is a very simple meaning of the procurement. We can say procurement refers to raising of funds externally, and important thing, utilization of funds means how the funds should be allocated, how the fund should be divided among the departments. This was not considered under the traditional approach of the finance function. This was the biggest limitation of the traditional approach. Now, if we talk about the limitations of traditional approach, because this approach is now not longer in practice, this is not in existence because this has been replaced by the modern approach. So if we talk about the limitations of the traditional approach, there are four or five limitations, and they are very simple to learn. First thing, as you know, this approach is confined only to the procurement of funds only, nothing else. Means if we say that allocation of funds is not considered, so it fails to consider an important aspect, that is allocation of funds. Second thing, it deals with only outsiders, that is investors, investment bankers, merchant bankers and other parties. It does not deal with the promoters of the organization. It traditional approach only focuses on the procurement of funds from the market. Now, the other than the outsiders, there is one more contributor towards the organization is owners. So this approach does not take into consideration the promoters' contribution. Final limitation of the traditional approach, that it ignores the working capital financing. It does not pay attention onto the working capital needs of the organization. So that is why, because of the above limitations, in the long run, traditional approach has been discarded. Now, the modern approach says what? That the finance function covers both acquisition of funds as well as the allocation of funds to various users. Now, this is the important part, as we have discussed, procurement of funds as well as allocation of funds. So as this aspect has been overlooked in the traditional approach, now this aspect has been covered into the modern approach. So financial management in modern approach is concerned with the issues involved in raising of funds and the efficient and wise allocation of the funds. So this is all about the modern approach. This is all about the scope of the financial management. Now, if we talk about the main contents of modern approach, that where the modern approach leads, what the modern approach of the financial management summarizes about the organization. So it advises the organization that how large should an enterprise be and how far it should grow. Means what should be the appropriate size of an organization and how much should it be expand. Second question it may answer, in what form should it hold its assets? It means in what form an organization should cap its assets, like in the form of tangible or intangible assets. Now the third thing, how should the funds required be raised? What is the amount of funds should be raised from the different sources of finance available in the capital market? So financial management is concerned with finding answer to the ever problems. So till now we have discussed that what is financial management, what is the scope of financial management, what is the different approaches which we have discussed, like the traditional approach and the modern approach. Now we are going to start the major topic, that what are the roles of a finance manager in an organization, what he or she is supposed to do. So we can say that there are three main functions which is performed by a finance manager in an organization. Now these three main functions we can summarize, these are investment decisions, financing decisions and dividend decisions. So if we talk about the investment decisions, so what the investment decision deals with? So if we define the investment decisions, we can say that it relates to the selection of assets in which funds will be invested by a firm. Now in shortcut, we can say that organization made two type of investments, long-term investments and short-term investments. Both investments are essential for the smooth running of an organization. So long-term investment, if we talk about that, long-term investment deals with the acquiring of fixed assets in an organization. So when an organization, for example, if it is want to purchase the land, building, plant, machinery, or equipments, it will have to go through the long-term investment decisions. And short-term investment decisions are basically related with the working capital management. So there are two techniques which helps a finance manager in facilitating the long-term investment decisions, and there is one more management for facilitating the short-term investment decisions. Like in long-term investment decision, a finance manager can use the concept of capital budgeting, which is broadly used for facilitating the long-term investment decisions. Again, I am saying this word, this long-term investment decisions is basically related with the acquiring of only fixed assets, nothing else. Fixed assets like plant, machinery, building, equipment, etc., etc. Short-term investment decisions, the technique which we generally use, it's working capital management. Working capital is a very big term in itself, and there is a detailed description of this concept in the coming up chapters. Working capital, in short, we can say that this is that capital which is required by the firm for maintaining its day-to-day operations, because the word here is written as working. So this working is basically emphasized on day-to-day working, routine working. So the capital which is used by the firm in its routine working, that capital is known as working capital. So this working capital management, so under working capital management, three types of management are done by a finance manager. We have cash management, we have receivables management, and then we have inventory management. These are the three, and we can have a look, you can find a connection between these three terms, that cash, receivables and inventory. All these three are the current assets, and current assets, in simple words, we can say this is the short term investment decisions. So investment decision, and now I hope that it is clear to you, this is the decision which is taken by a finance manager regarding the investment in short term assets and in the long term assets. Short term assets, we can say about the current assets. Now we are coming on to the second decision. After the investment decisions, we have the second decision of financing decision. Now, before starting the financing decision, we can have an example that suppose if we want to purchase a four-wheeler. Now, we do not have enough funds in our hand. Then what we will do? Definitely, we are going to help a bank to finance our need. So that is the crux of financing decision, that when we take the help of a third party to finance our financial requirements, then it will come under the purview of financing decisions. So financing decisions is basically concerned with that the investment which have been finalized by the firm in the first phase, means in the investment decision. For example, organization have decided that it is going to purchase a machinery worth rupees 50 lakh. Now from where the 50 lakh would come? So this would be decided under the second category of decisions, which is known as financing decisions. So financing decisions is basically relates with sources of finance, that what sources an organization should use for financing its requirement of worth rupees 50 lakh to purchase a machine. Now there are n number of sources available in the capital market. So all those sources can be categorized into the two terms, debt and equity. So debt capital is basically known as borrowed capital, and equity is represents the ownership component or owned capital. So this is the crux of the financing decisions, that financing decisions is basically relates with the optimal mix of equity and debt. So one of the best combination of debt and equity is determined into the financing decisions. So the next step is raising the appropriate amount through the available sources. So we are discussing about the financing decision. So financing decision is basically deals with optimum combination of debt with equity. And in short, we can have a look that combination of debt and equity creates the capital structure. So this is the topic which we again read in the coming up chapters of the financial management, that what is capital structure. But for the time being, we should have a clear cut understanding that in capital structure, there is a combination of debt and equity, and whenever there is a combination of debt with equity, it means that organization is going to satisfy some of its financial requirements, and that is why it is exploring the external capital market. So now I hope that financing decisions is clear to all of you. We have done investment decisions, we have done financing decisions. Now we are coming on to the third and important part of the final decision making, which is known as dividend decisions. So first of all, we should know that what is dividend. So dividend, if we want to define in a very simple term, dividend is a part of profit which is distributed by the firm among its shareholders. Suppose if somebody asks you that why are you investing in a firm? What is the purpose of investment in a firm? If somebody asks you that invest 10,000 rupees in Reliance Industries Limited, so definitely you will ask that what is our benefit? So your benefit is basically known as the return in the language of financial management. So the firm which takes your money pays you something, and that return is known as dividend. So dividend, we can say, is a term which is used as a return from the shareholder's point of view, and the same dividend is considered as a cost from the company point of view. So dividend decision in the investment financing and the third category of dividend decision is basically concerned with that how much amount of dividend should be distributed by the firm to their shareholders. So which course of action should be followed? So the decision depends upon the preference of the shareholders and the investment opportunities available to the firm. Now there are two important terms here. Whenever a company creates profit, for example, this is a very simple concept. Organization creates profit. Now it will have to decide upon that how much amount of profit should be accumulated by the firm and how much amount of profit should be distributed by the firm. So if I am writing here dividend, so here I am taking into consideration the preference of shareholders, because the shareholder wants the return on their invested money. But if you paid all your profit to your shareholders in the form of dividend, then you will suffer your retained earnings. So retained earnings represents what? Retained earnings represents the accumulation of profit. So if I say profit of a firm is 10 rupees, now this is not the correct nomenclature. In fact, we use the term EPS. So for the sake of convenience, we are taking here the term profit. So if I am saying we are taking the profit of a firm is 10 rupees, and if the organization is paying the dividend of 3 rupees, then you automatically get the answer. What should be the proportion of retained earnings? It is 7 rupees. So if I am going to increase this part, this retained earnings portion would automatically be get reduced. If I am going to dividend 4, it becomes 6. If this is 5, this is also 5. This is 6, this is 4. So in the same way, now this is the balance between the dividend and retained earnings which have to be maintained by the finance manager. This is not an easy decision to take. Because this, why this is not easy? Because if you are going to satisfy the shareholders, you are going to sacrifice the future investment opportunities. If you do not have enough funds in your hand, then for the coming of future projects, you will have to depend upon the outside sources, like raising of new capital from the market in the form of shares or in the form of debt or in the form of other instruments which we will discuss in the coming up chapter. So dividend decisions has a strong influence on the market price of the share. Yes, it is a direct connected with the market price of the share. If you are not paying dividend to your shareholders would feel dissatisfied and the demand goes down. And when the demand goes down, there is a very simple principle of economics that the market price of that commodity also goes down. So, finance manager have to keep that point into the mind that dividend has a strong influence on the market price of the share. So, the dividend policy is to be determined in term of its impact on shareholders' value. Yes, shareholders' value, again, the fourth part of the fourth chapter of the part one, we are coming on to the shareholders' value. So, the optimum dividend policy is one which maximizes the value of shares and wealth of the shareholders. Now, value of shares and wealth of the shareholders, we are going to start in our next topic after this. Therefore, the summary of all the three financial decisions, we can say that these three financial decisions are interconnected, they are interwoven in such a way that they act and react on one another. You cannot take one decision in isolation with the other two decisions. We have a simple connection. We can take an example. You have decided to invest in a machine worth rupees 50 lakh. Now, you have decided to invest in a machine. This is an investment decision. Now, how to raise this 50 lakh rupees from the market? This comes under the financing decisions. And when the returns comes to the organization in the form of profit, whether it is gross or net, how much should be retained and how much should be paid as dividend? So, can we say that all these three decisions are significantly act and react on one another and therefore they should be taken jointly, not in separation or not in isolation with one another, because they ultimately determine the value of the firm. Yes, now we are coming on to the last topic of the part one. This is the objectives of financial management. Now, there are two broad objectives. As we have discussed, two approaches to the financial management. In the same way, there are two broad objectives of the financial management. And this particular question may come in some other way also, that discuss the concept of profit maximization versus wealth maximization. Because these are the two broad objectives of the financial management. Number one, profit maximization. Number two, wealth maximization. Now, in the advance, I am telling you that the first objective, means profit maximization objective, has been discarded and wealth maximization objective has been adopted by the financial management since a very long period of time. So, first of all, we should understand what is profit maximization and why the organizations has rejected this concept. And what is the biggest quality of wealth maximization that it has been adopted by the firm? So, now we are going to start the concept of profit maximization. So, what the term profit maximization is saying? The term profit here is basically replica of the economic efficiency of a firm. Profit maximization approach simply says that an organization should pursue all those efforts, all those activities which can raise the profitability of a firm, because profit is the only parameter for judging or measuring the efficiency of an organization. The yardstick, if we have the two firms, for example, X and Y. Now, if somebody asks you that which firm is more efficient, then definitely the basic parameter for the purpose of judging the efficiency of a firm is the profit. So, the profit of a firm, the firm whose profit is bigger than its competitor, we simply say that firm is more efficient. Now, profit maximization approach says what? An organization should do all the activities which can maximize the proportion of its profitability, because they said what? That for measuring the efficiency, the only and only barometer, or we can say the only yardstick, is only the profit. So, that's why they emphasize a lot on the maximization of the profit. But in the long run, this approach has been discarded. This approach has been rejected. Now, we should understand that why this approach has been rejected, because there is a clear-cut system behind the rejection of this approach, there are some biggest limitations of this profit maximization approach. So we can start the limitations one by one here. First limitation of the profit maximization approach, that this approach does not consider the concept of time value of money. Yes, this is the first and foremost limitation of the profit maximization approach, that this approach does not consider the concept of time value of money. Now, what is time value of money? In simple terms, we can say that today's 10,000 rupees is not equal to the next year 10,000 rupees in terms of purchasing power. For example, if you buy a particular commodity in today's date in 10,000 rupees, you cannot buy the same commodity next year in 10,000 rupees. So they do not consider this aspect. They says what? The followers of the profit maximization approach says what? Any firm should generate profit, whether it is coming in the current days or whether it is coming into the coming up years. They do not consider the concept of time value of money. Second limitation of the PM approach, the term profit is vague. It means foggy. We can have a look that the concept of profit is vague. Vague means it is not clear. So we can say that that's why we reject this approach in the long run. There are one more. It avoids risk associated with a project. It avoids the risk associated with a project because it only studies about the return, and that's why it has been discarded into the long run. Now, in the long run, when you have discarded the profit maximization approach, now it has been replaced by the wealth maximization approach. So, wealth maximization approach is saying what? It totally focused on maximizing the wealth of a shareholder. Now, how the wealth of a shareholder is computed? There is a simple formula for computing the wealth of shareholder. W is equal to N into P naught, where W is representing the wealth of the shareholder. N is representing the number of shares held by a shareholder. P naught is representing the current market price per share. So, when a firm considers the wealth of a shareholder into that consideration, then automatically what happens? The share price goes up and ultimately the value of firm goes up. Always remember, there are two aspects on which organization always focuses a lot. First approach is share of the firm, the market price of the share should go up. Second aspect which the organization seeks is the value of firm should also go up, and both these two objectives can be accomplished only with the wealth maximization approach. So, wealth maximization approach simply focuses on to the maximization of the wealth of shareholders. Now, if this is going to be the increase, for example, you have 10 shares and the market price of one share is 100. So, the wealth of a shareholder is 1000. And if an organization is doing so well that the share price goes up, then with the same number of shares, the wealth goes up. For example, the share price now goes up to 110. Now, the wealth of the shareholder becomes 1100 rupees in place of 1000 rupees. Now, without increasing the number of shares in the portfolio, a shareholder can increase its wealth because the organization did so well that there is a huge demand into the capital market, and when the demand goes up, we simply know market price also goes up, and therefore the wealth of the shareholders also goes up. So with one instance, we can have rising in the share price and rising in the wealth of the shareholders. So with this concept, it is the end of the approach of profit maximization versus wealth maximization approach. In this session, we have discussed what is the basic concept of financial management? What is its scope? In the scope, we have discussed the different approaches like traditional approach and modern approach. And then we have discussed the major financial decisions, or we can say the role of finance manager in an organization, the major decision areas like investment decisions, financing decisions and dividend decisions. And in the last topic, we have discussed the concept of profit maximization and wealth maximization. I hope this session would be enjoyable. So we will meet again in the next session. Till then, thank you very much.